The Greek philosopher Aristotle was born in 384 BCE. The Italian philosopher St. Thomas Aquinas was born in 1225. Galileo Galilei was born on February 15, 1564. Between the three of them, there is a story that spans almost 2,000 years. That story is known as the Galileo Affair. The story of the Galileo Affair is a popular one, and while I was in grad school, I did some research on the Galileo Affair, so I had a tough time narrowing it down to a short podcast and a video. So, for the month of February, to commemorate Galileo's birthday, this podcast on Galileo will be in two parts. If there is a moment in the history of science that defined the way we look at science and religion, it would be the Galileo Affair. Born on February 15, 1564, Galileo Galilei is considered the father of modern science. Growing up, he was denied the opportunity to learn mathematics. He wanted to study theology and considered becoming a priest. However, his father wanted him to become educated and join the field of medicine, and so he attended the University of Pisa. One day, while attending church services at the Cathedral of Pisa, he became intrigued by a chandelier that was being pushed by the air, and it would move in wide arcs and then in small arcs. While watching the chandelier swing, he realized that regardless of the amplitude of the swing, the chandelier was always swung at the same time. He tested this revelation by monitoring his heart's pulse on his wrist while watching the chandelier. When he got home, he set up two chandeliers, and he arranged to make broad sweeps for one chandelier, and the other one he was going to make short sweeps. He found that his theory was correct, and that the chandeliers always swung simultaneously. Galileo became fascinated with geometry, and eventually convinced his father to study mathematics instead of medicine. So, he stayed at the University of Pisa, where he completed his studies in mathematics. He remained there after he was finished, where he would eventually earn the chair in mathematics in 1589. His theories on gravity did not agree with the university's Aristotelian foundation of science, so the university forced him out. After that, he accepted a position at the University of Padua, where he also earned the chair in mathematics. During this time at Padua, he learned about a new tool called the telescope. This telescope allowed him to see things in the sky that were once reserved for the eyes of God only. As a scientist, his discoveries in physics were groundbreaking. In 1623, Galileo published the Essayer Il Sagittore, which supported mathematics and the process of experimentation to uphold his theories. In the Essayer, Galileo asserted his beliefs in atomism, which states that the world is composed of indivisible particles. Unfortunately, this work shook the authoritative grounds of the church and ultimately led to his arrest. In the 13th century, the Inquisition, an institution of the Catholic Church, was formed to seek out and punish heretics. On June 22, 1633, the Inquisition sentenced the scientist, philosopher, and mathematician to prison. They charged him for vehement suspicion of heresy, which was a religious crime more severe than a slight suspicion of heresy, but not as serious as a formal heresy. According to the indictment, sentence, and abjuration court documents of 1633, the charges were that Galileo espoused the false doctrine taught by some that the sun is the center of the world. Church guards then ushered him to jail, and the next day he was escorted to his home, where he would remain under house arrest until his death in 1642. Had Galileo been accused of formal heresy, the church would have ordered his death. However, he was not accused of formal heresy because he arranged for a plea bargain. And in this plea bargain, the Inquisition informed him that he would not be put to death if he admitted to going too far with heliocentrism. The suspicions of Galileo's heresy revolve around his works as a scientist and his heliocentric discoveries. His insight questioned the validity of the church's scientific belief system founded in Aristotelian philosophies. The church taught and believed that the earth was geocentric, meaning that the earth was the center of the universe. But Galileo was just building his theory upon the findings of Nicholas Copernicus. The story of Copernicus is fascinating because his heliocentric approach was based on his observations without a telescope. In 1543, just a few months before his death, Copernicus published his manuscript on the revolutions of the celestial spheres. In this manuscript, Copernicus describes his heliocentric theory based on assumptions. These assumptions are that in the solar system, there are celestial circles. There is no one center for all these circles, and that the center of the earth is not the center of the universe, but instead, the sun is the center of the universe. But these were assumptions. Copernicus didn't utilize the Holy Scripture to support his view. Nevertheless, the church wouldn't let Copernicus get away with this. In 1559, the Catholic Church placed Copernicus's book on the Index of Forbidden Books. Sadly and conveniently, Copernicus passed away shortly after he published these findings, so he couldn't be tried for heresy. However, Galileo did not. So why did Galileo's defense to the court fail? There are several theories, one of which is that when Galileo published his book, The Dialogue on the Two Chief World Systems, the dialogue from within the book offended Pope Urban VIII. The Pope believed that Galileo was mocking him and implying that he was a fool. You see, in Galileo's book, there is a character named Simplicio. The name Simplicio refers to a simple-minded man. In this book, the character Simplicio refused to look through the telescope to see with his own eyes that the earth was not the center of the universe. Furthermore, Simplicio was a devoted follower of Ptolemy and Aristotle. But why would the Pope take this personally? Especially considering that at one point years before, Cardinal Maffeo Barberini became Pope Urban VIII, he and Galileo were actually close friends. Their friendship had spanned many years, and they were very close. But when Barberini became Pope, he and Galileo had a falling out. Thus, this decaying friendship also possibly contributed to the details of Galileo's conviction. On top of the rumors and the deteriorated friendship, the Pope was also under a great deal of stress. There had been some talk among the College of the Cardinals to impeach the Pope due to the politics that were unfolding during the 30 Years' War. Additionally, the Pope had nefarious informers telling him that Galileo was calling him a simple-minded fool. Being called a simple-minded fool did not look good for the Pope. So what was the complete foundation to the purpose of the Inquisition against Galileo? Well, the reason is that the application of science, as it was dictated by the Catholic Church in the 13th century, was espoused by St. Thomas Aquinas, who used the ideas of Aristotle in his philosophical theories. So how did Aristotle, who lived 2,000 years before Galileo, contribute to the Galileo Affair? Well, the evolution of Aristotelianism began around the time that Aristotle flourished in Alexandria, Egypt, around 360 BCE. Though Aristotle was a student of Plato, he eventually disagreed with many of Plato's philosophical theories and created his own system of reasoning. Thus, he rejected Plato's methods of idealism and formed his own philosophy steeped in realism. Aristotle studied at the Platonic Academy for 20 years, until 347, when he founded the Lyceum Academy. Aristotle then taught Alexander the Great, who founded Alexandria, Egypt. And for those who are unfamiliar with Alexander the Great, he had a vision of creating a city built on academia. Who wouldn't love that, right? Thus, it is fitting that Aristotle's theories are foundational to the philosophies of academia. Aristotle's work was so vast that encompassed approximately 200 treatises. even though only 31 of his works survived. In each of his treatises, Aristotle employed the process of informal logic, argumentation, and deceptive reasoning. According to Aristotle, science is designated into three classes: theoretical, practical, and productive. The purpose of these domains, he proposed, is to determine which scientific discipline belongs in each domain. One can conduct this process by identifying the goals in the discipline. Some sciences are meant for practice and production. In contrast, other sciences are specifically theoretical and presume no other purpose than to obtain knowledge. To determine these goals, Aristotle stated that one must apply the four causes of being to each discipline to determine which domain the discipline belongs to. These four causes include material cause, formal cause, efficient cause, and final cause. Aristotle's work was so groundbreaking that his level of logic and analysis changed how scientists worked and answered the question, why? Aristotle taught a philosophy that was structured similarly to the three-step Socratic method. And Aristotle reasoned that if a person presented an argument, if the premises are true, then the outcome of the discussion would also be true. Aristotle, employing informal logic, argumentation, and deceptive reasoning, addressed tangible things, including the cosmos. He also taught that the combination of morality and reality is Stoicism. Aristotle believed that some sciences are meant for practice and production. In contrast, other sciences are specifically theoretical and presume no other purpose than to obtain knowledge. The Dominican theologian Thomas Aquinas was so enamored with Aristotle's teachings and presentation of Stoicism that he used aspects of Aristotle's writings to illustrate Christian theology. Thomas Aquinas was born in 1225 in an area now known as Lazio, Italy. His father, Landulf of Aquino, was a knight who served Emperor Frederick. As a result, his father was a military man and had sway over the politics of Italy. And even though most of his family went into the military, Aquinas had his sights set on the abbacy. By the time he was 19 years old, he was studying at a university in Naples, where he was exposed to the teaching of Aristotle. He was also introduced to the Dominican preacher John of St. Julian, who influenced Aquinas to join the Dominican order. The Dominican order is an order of preachers within the Catholic Church. There is a wonderful historian by the name of Rivka Feldhay, who wrote this really good book, Galileo in the Church, and it's an academic book, but regardless, I highly recommend it if you're interested in learning more about Galileo and the Inquisition. In this article that she wrote titled Authority, Political Theology, and the Politics of Knowledge in the Transition from Medieval to Early Modern Catholicism, notes that at this time the Catholic Church was divided. Feldhay argues that the Roman Catholic Church was not monolithic. Instead, she explains that the church had two divisions: conservative, controlled by the Dominicans, and progressive, controlled by the Jesuits. The Dominicans adhered to the writings of Thomas Aquinas and the foundations of Aristotle. They also developed an epistemology that viewed Copernicanism as unproved and unprovable. Furthermore, according to Feldhay, the Jesuits had developed a dialogue with Galileo, but attempted to control his science institutionally by suspending the philosophical implications of Copernicanism. Aquinas' determination to join the Dominican order did not go well with the family. In fact, it turned into a year-long disaster for Aquinas. If you are interested to know what happens next, stay tuned for my next video and podcast, which will be published privately on my Patreon page in 1 week and publicly in 2 weeks. If you are interested in hearing the second part of this podcast in 1 week, come on over to patreon.com/math science history and sign up to be a patron. As a patron, you can receive early releases of the podcast and video, as well as exclusive content that I only post on Patreon, depending on the tier that you choose. And also depending on the tier that you choose, your name will be listed as a patron on my website, and you will receive a note of recognition on my podcast, as well as on my YouTube videos. So, stay tuned for the follow-up story on Aquinas and Galileo, and until next time, Carpe Diem!